This podcast is an invitation to feel and experience the souls of famous old Hollywood homes and to have an in-depth journey to the areas where they're located through interviews with longtime residents. Either you're a fan of old Hollywood in Los Angeles, planning to have a vacation, or, an even bigger step, considering a certain area for your future home. This is your opportunity to receive valuable information and insightful advice you won't find anywhere else.
Hello, hello, and welcome to my podcast. Are you in the mood for California? Today, we'll feel and experience Nat King Cole's life in Los Angeles, featuring an interview with incredibly talented Eddie Wakes.
That story is told where he was part of a musical group, a traveling tour called Shuffle Along. And it was mostly black cast. I don't know who the producers were, but part of that tour brought them to Los Angeles. And by then, Nat was just really soaring in his artistry, you know, as a pianist at first, and then later on as, you know him as a trio, probably one of the biggest impacts on what we know to be musical or instrumental trios in music history, probably one of the most impactful and definitive. But he and the rest of the cast were in L.A. as part of that tour, and the promoter ran away with the money.
Masha Korpacheva is a California-based realtor and a member of the National Association of Realtors in Los Angeles. She's an advocate for selling and buying homes with soul and practicing mindfulness in real estate. With master's degrees in spiritual psychology and linguistics, Masha brings all of her skills to work with her clients. An intuit and empath, she has touched many lives with her outstanding ability to see beyond the visible and helping to come to better understanding of issues and their resolutions. An adventurous world traveler, from climbing Mount Kilimanjaro in Tanzania to exploring the Galapagos Islands, Masha has a particular passion for the City of Angels. Having landed in this paradise and adopted it as her home, she's been sharing old Hollywood stories since 2007. In the mood for California, feel the soul of old Hollywood.
And now, are you ready to experience the life of Nat King Cole in Los Angeles? In the sweltering summer of 1948, Nat King Cole, with his smooth baritone that could melt even the coldest hearts, was riding the crest of fame, alongside his new bride, the glamorous singer Maria Hawkins. He was on a quest. The couple was not merely searching for a home. They were seeking a sanctuary, a place where they could finally put down roots after years of restless touring. Los Angeles beckoned, with its palm-lined streets and golden sunsets, and in the prestigious enclave of Hancock Park, they found a grand estate that seemed to mirror Cole's rising stardom. This wasn't just any house. It was a stately Tudor-style mansion made of earthy brick, nestled on South Muirfield Road, with a price tag of $85,000, a princely sum for the time, but well within reach for one of the most celebrated voices in America. The Coles had already grown weary of the bustling tourists and autograph seekers of Beverly Hills, and Maria, a woman of refined taste and elegance, was eager to find a place worthy of their growing dreams. The moment they stepped through the great white oak door, Nat felt it, a connection, an undeniable sense that this was home. "This is it," he declared. His eyes were sweeping over the grand staircase even before they had explored the rest of the house. Maria, ever the socialite, with a lineage as impeccable as her taste, was entranced by the possibilities. They knew they had found their kingdom, a place where they could raise a family, entertain, and build a life together. But as quickly as their dream began to take shape, dark clouds gathered on the horizon. Despite their wealth, fame, and charm, the Coles were Black, and Hancock Park was an exclusive whites-only neighborhood. The elegant mansions and manicured lawns were the domain of old Los Angeles money, oil barons, banking tycoons, and real estate magnates. The Coles' arrival was seen as a breach of the neighborhood's unspoken code, and soon the Hancock Park Property Owners Association, led by the attorney Andrew J. Kopp Jr., was scheming to prevent them from moving in. The association's efforts were cloaked in secrecy, but their intentions were clear. Kopp himself approached Nat's manager with an offer, rescind the purchase, and they would return his money with a bit of profit. But Nat, ever the gentleman with a backbone of steel, responded with a sly smile, if you give me $1 million, I'll leave the country. The bribe fell flat, and with that, the Coles found themselves embroiled in a battle for their right to call Hancock Park home. Threats and harassment followed. Colonel Harry Gantz, the former owner, and Ann Winters, the real estate agent who facilitated the sale, were targeted by angry residents. Winters received chilling threats, warning her that she'd face a serious automobile accident if she didn't rescind the sale. Yet, despite the mounting pressure, the Coles stood firm, offering Winters bodyguards and legal support, even as she turned to the Beverly Hills police for protection. Nat and Maria, unshaken by the escalating tension, held a press conference at the Watkins Hotel. Nat's voice, which had soothed countless souls through his music, now carried a message of quiet resolve. This is not an act of defiance, he explained. My bride and I like this house. I can afford it, and we would like to make it our home. Despite the Coles' pleas for understanding, the neighborhood remained steadfast in its opposition. Kopp even filed an affidavit stating that the Coles were forbidden from moving in because they were not Christian Caucasians. However, the law was on the Coles' side. The Supreme Court had already struck down restrictive covenants in the landmark Shelley versus Kramer case, and the Coles had every legal right to their new home. As news of their struggle spread, the Coles found themselves at the center of a national conversation about civil rights and racial equality. Even Eleanor Roosevelt, moved by a letter from Maria's influential aunt, Charlotte Hawkins Brown, offered her support. Yet, despite the growing outcry, the Coles faced relentless hostility. Undeterred, they moved into their Muirfield mansion in August 1948, only to find a vile sign planted in their yard, a cruel reminder of the hatred that simmered beneath the surface of their new community. But Nat and Maria were determined to rise above it. Maria, with her indomitable spirit, took charge of turning the house into a home, decorating it with a sleek, modern style that reflected her sophisticated taste. The years that followed were both challenging and rewarding. The Coles' home became a showplace, a testament to their resilience and grace under fire. They raised five children, including the future singing star Natalie Cole, in a home that, despite the threats and prejudice, was filled with love and music. The neighborhood slowly began to accept them, realizing that the Coles were not just good neighbors, but exceptional ones. By the time Nat passed away in 1965, he had become a beloved figure in Hancock Park, a symbol of quiet dignity and perseverance. Years later, in 2003, the community that had once fought so hard to keep the Coles out honored Nat King Cole by naming a post office after him. His daughter Carol, reflecting on her father's legacy, noted how much he had done for civil rights without ever making a fuss about it. And for Natalie, the mansion on Muirfield Road would always hold a special place in her heart, a place where, despite the odds, her family had found a home that was truly unforgettable.
Unforgettable. That's what you are. Unforgettable, though near or far. Like a song of love that clings to me, how the thought of you does things to me. Never before has someone been more.
And here we are. Welcome to Los Angeles. I'm so excited to have Eddie Wakes here with me. From Walt Disney Theatrical to La La Land, Eddie has turned heads when he sings. Eddie's life as a singer is the stuff movies are made of. From performing at the Super Bowl as a youngster to being discovered years later singing on the street in Los Angeles by Hollywood A-listers to performing for and with legends. That's because when Eddie sings, he turns heads. As Academy Award-winning director Damien Chazelle says, "You don't hear many voices like his today. Rich, delicate, and effortlessly beautiful. Eddie Wakes' vocal style is reminiscent of another time. Eddie has a velvety, wide-range baritone that doesn't sound like other contemporary singers today. He gets rave reviews. He is a tremendous singer," says Elvis Costello.
"That's why, darling, it's incredible that someone so unforgettable thinks that I am unforgettable too."
Thank you very much for the 1951 hit, Unforgettable. Thank you.
Eddie hails from Topeka, Kansas, within his own family, a lineage of musical prowess serves as his guiding light. He sang with his eight brothers. His father was a pastor and a phenomenal singer. Lionel Hampton asked him to sing with his big band, and Eddie, in turn, honed his skills in the vibrant crucible of church and school talent showcases. Eddie says, "I associated my love for music with my love for family. It was the covalent bond that defined, really, how I saw myself, my family, my community." Eddie continues, "Who were my great influences growing up singing? Well, my older brothers, and of course, the countless icons who influenced them. Sam Cooke, Frank Sinatra, Nat King Cole, Billy Eckstein, Johnny Hartman, Aretha Franklin, Ella Fitzgerald, even James Brown. Now with management, an agent, and a record label in place, Eddie is about to embark on his most ambitious project to date in support of his debut album, Street Singer. Backed by a world-class quartet, Eddie will tour extensively, domestically and abroad. Please check out Eddie's website, www.eddiewakes.com, and follow him on Instagram at eddiewakes. Eddie will share with us some very interesting facts about Nat King Cole. Hello, Eddie.
Hello, Marcia. How are you doing? It's been a long time.
It's been a long time, for sure, Eddie. I wish, you know, we were in touch more frequently, but I'm so thrilled to actually have you as my guest on the podcast today. It's really, really exciting.
Well, thank you. It's a pleasure. Pleasure to be here and share. Based on a subject, it's definitely a very, very pivotal and consequential, you know, part of my life, Los Angeles.
Yes, 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 very true. And, you know, I was really looking forward to talking to you about Nat King Cole, because in so many ways, you embody him and his art and his music. And maybe you could share, like, what is this connection to Nat King Cole that you have found within yourself? And when did you first become aware of Nat King Cole? And what impact, actually, did he have on your own musical journey?
Very good question. I think I was probably a kid, I would imagine 12, 13 years old, something in that range, back in the Midwest, when my father and I would be hearing on the radio different singers. And of course, some singers are very good, but in others, they transport you. And Nat Cole was one of those singers. And I have to say, I heard him sing, and not just a lot. It was a spiritual transport to somewhere that sometimes I'm not even able to describe back in the day. Amazing to hear him, his tone, his quality. He had a genius and an otherworldliness to his approach to phrasing and again, to melody and structure. Even his, you know, the way he parsed out the songs, you know, with the lyrics. He would actually, he and Frank did this a lot at Capitol Records. They would kind of write out the phrase on a cue card or index cards, mm-hmm. and then phonetically go through them to see how it best suits not only the melody of the song, but also the arrangements. And they had some amazing arrangers, some very, very genius and arrangers that were just as involved with the creation of pop music, as we call it. So they would do that ahead of time. But anyway, just hearing that back in those days, I was not able to put any of that or understand any of that stuff. I just later dissected it through the years. But he just took you to another place in his, you know, with his spiritual gift of singing. And I think I was probably around, I'd say between 10 and 14 years old.
Wow. That must have been very special.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. You know, at that time, you don't know what's going on. You just know this is a singular experience that kind of stands alone, you know, in your life and in your understanding of what music is. And it never let me go. I guess it's like it hooked me at that point. And I just fell in love with that guy's voice. And I realized later on, to answer the rest of that, you know, coming from the African-American or Black community, church was the conveyant bond of everything we did socially, community, politically. Everything was centered around church. And of course, Nat had that background as well, where even music was influenced by it.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, later I got a chance to be mentored and have build relationships with people that were close to him and who worked with him in his career. But yeah, Nat's father was a pastor. My father was a pastor. We grew up in music, and that music, popular music, kind of shaped how we approached our artistry. And for him, it was Earl Father Hines, the great pianist. It was Louis Armstrong. It was
you know, Frank Sinatra, of course, they became real close friends. Of course, Nat was at Capitol Records before Frank was at Capitol Records, and they began to have their own careers. But yeah, church music, being the creators of jazz music, which was really the bedrock of pop music as we know it, certainly back then. And it later became big band and a lot of orchestration. So it was like this blending of church music, which was expressed through jazz and blues, to that European classical music, Brahms, Mendelssohn, Tchaikovsky, Beethoven, all those influences came together. And I would say it probably really did the largest expression when, you know, with the Hebraic or Jewish influence of that music, classical music as well, and then the black jazz blues during the what we call the Harlem Renaissance.
Mm-hmm.
Back in the 1920s and to the 30s, and you know, all that came together and just caused a crescendo of within the arts, and including music for sure, fashion and everything back then. I think you saw a similar thing back in the 30s in Berlin, because in Berlin it was very advanced, very progressive, and had what we saw expressed during the Harlem Renaissance over there.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I think that that just impacted everything, and it certainly put its mark on the Black experience in America at that time. And I guess I was a recipient of that through the years.
Yes, yes.
Generation later or two.
Yes, I absolutely agree that Nat King Cole's mark on the music scene, you know, was absolutely indelible. And a lot of his life, he also lived in Los Angeles. So maybe you could tell us a little bit, you know, about like what brought him here and what was it like?
I have to laugh because, I mean, I've heard this story several times. Of course, he shared it. I remember when we did the, I sent you a clip, I'm sure you saw
yes.
it, of me and Tony Bennett and Johnny Mathis and Harry Belafonte and Natalie Cole, Maria, his wife, his widow, and several others that really, you know, shared about, you know, just their understanding of Nat's life and his impact, influence. But yeah, he came to, you know, that story is told where he was part of a musical group, a traveling tour called Shuffle Along. And it was, you know, mostly black cast. I don't know who the producers were, but part of that tour brought them to Los Angeles. And by then, Nat was just really soaring in his artistry, you know, as a pianist at first, and then later on as, you know him as a trio, probably one of the biggest impacts on what we know to be musical or instrumental trios in music history, probably one of the most impactful
mm-hmm.
and definitive. But he and the rest of the cast were in LA as part of that tour, and the promoter ran away with the money. So they were stuck.
That's crazy, crazy.
They got stuck in Los Angeles with nowhere to go and you know, with no money. So I guess during that time, Nat decided to stay, and others did as well. I think a few notables. I can't recall now that list, but Nat was one of the ones that were, you know, that were basically victimized by that, the producer who took the money and ran away.
Mm-hmm.
And that started his whole life in Los Angeles.
Interesting. Very interesting. So eventually, I'm sure when Nat King Cole, you know, starting getting gigs and playing his music in Los Angeles, you know, at some point he chose to live in Hancock Park.
Right.
And that was a very significant and bold decision at that time. And do you know by any chance why he chose that particular neighborhood and what impact did his residence there actually have on the community and on his life?
Well, contrary to popular belief, Jim Crow and segregation was not only in the South. He decided, you know what, I want the best for my family. And I think that my career, you know, the exploits and accomplishments, I think that my house should be commensurate or an expression of that success. And of course, very similar to how Beverly Hills is today, Hancock was back then, Hancock Park.
Yes.
So he decided to get a house. Now, he did it through an agent or a lawyer friend of his. And so they were not aware that he was the person purchasing the house. And I think maybe he did that because he understood there were certain constraints regarding race.
Right.
But he did that. And as soon as he moved in, the neighbors went crazy. And it was quite interesting, too, because a lot of those, as George, another people, one of the people that were in the documentary, was George, what is George's last name? Benson. George Benson, the great guitarist, singer. He said, yeah, a lot of those guys had records of Nat in their house, but they didn't want him in their neighborhood.
Isn't it bizarre? Right. It's like,
right. Isn't it crazy? So, you know, a lot of these ironies and the hypocrisy. But he persisted. He decided, you know, of course, they burned the word, the N-word on his lawn.
Wow.
They killed his dog, one of his dogs that he had.
Oh, my God.
Oh, yeah, it was crazy. And I remember them talking about it in that very documentary that we did. Maria said, you know what? I'm a fighter. And, of course, Nat, in his quiet, subdued, gracious way, was a fighter as well. But his fight was really through persistence and through patience. And he believed that there was a higher good that would eventually be consummated in just maintaining his career, sending the messages of his beautiful and, you know, ingenious gift, mm-hmm. and it would win the day. He just believed that.
Unbelievable.
Maria was a fighter, though.
Wow.
Yeah. So, yeah, they persisted and ended up staying there. They stayed, and I think eventually, you know, the neighbors kind of calmed down and all was well with the world.
Wow. What an incredible, you know, family they were. And Nat King Cole must have had this just magnanimous and full of grace heart that only a person like he could have, you know, gone through all of that. Wow.
Yeah. Every person that the maverick that break down the barriers, it does take a lot of patience in it. And it's a very particular, a strategic approach. Frank, not so much in Las Vegas. He was pretty direct, but now he had resources and support of the very group that controlled Vegas.
Yes. Yes. Very true. So what a remarkable career he had, and so many challenges, especially as we just discussed, challenges regarding racial barriers that he faced, and navigating these challenges with this kindness and gracefulness, and, you know, in a very quiet and yet very, very strong way, you know, that must have really changed the society at the core. I strongly feel that it did. So what would you think that we can learn from those experiences today? How would you say some maybe special aspects of Cole's artistry that you find most inspiring or maybe influential even in your own work?
Is a blend. Music is with that, you know, music has really no real barrier.
Mm-hmm.
You have music that comes from the South. You have music that comes from the West. You have music that comes from various cultural influences and traditions. And the amazing thing is when it comes together, all those elements come together, they make something amazing and beautiful. And I think consciously, subconsciously, spiritually, intellectually, people begin to see, you know what? If each of these groups and peoples can make this contribution for something that is absolutely stunning and beautiful, singular, and life-changing, impactful, then society should really practice the same sort of discipline and freedom expressions in general. I think that's ultimately what really helped. Mm-hmm. Because music, without music, you don't have the civil rights movement.
Yes.
All of these various people that contributed music of various types. You have Bob Dylan, who was a Jewish young, you know, hippie type, brilliant composer in his own right, an artist who did Blowing in the Wind. And then that song influences the likes of Sam Cooke, who heard it and said, wow, that impacted so much. I want to write my own version of that mess. And he did it with The Change Is Going to Come. But all of these people contributing together, all of them fighting for the same thing, the good of man. And man being good to each other. And that was the power of music across the board. And of course, music is you know, it just does everything. It gives wings to the human spirit.
Yes. So, Eddie, can you share maybe some personal stories or even anecdotes about how Nat King Cole's music has impacted your own life or career?
Oh, yeah. Very recently, right after that documentary, Nat's arranger, who was also part of that documentary, Mr. Ralph Carmichael, we connected. And by then he was 94 years old.
Oh, wow.
And still young, still vibrant. Some of the music across the board that impacted my life growing up in church, the songs we sang were through artists or by artists that Ralph, because he had his own label, he mind because he was, you know, that we used to cover, whose material we covered a lot, and growing up in church and stuff. I remember as a, 12-year-old kid, 14-year-old kid directing the choir, as part of the church and whatnot. And in school, Ralph Carmichael was a great mentor and a friend. And the biggest compliment he gave me was telling me, hey, you know what? You remind me of Nat. He said, actually, I'll send you the letter at some point. But he sent me a letter, and him and Mar, who's been married for 6+ years. He said, we listened to you again, Eddie, and actually, you're better than Nat. I said, I don't believe that, but thank you. Yeah, so he helped me put a few things together with this recording. We haven't released it yet, but, strings, members of LA Philharmonic and stuff, piece by piece. And of course, he's an endearing part of this next chapter or two, but just a gracious, loving guy. He told me a story. He said Nat and he were doing a recording of That Sunday, That Summer, which is one of my favorite tunes by Nat. Mm-hmm. And in fact, John Kennedy said it was his favorite song.
Oh.
But he was in the studio recording that song at Capitol. He told me, he said, we got there. All the choir was ready because it is choral parts throughout. And the orchestra was ready and the producer was in the booth. And then I'm looking through the music, making sure everybody had all their music as he took the stand for the conductor. And he said that I realized I didn't finish the ending of this song. So he told his choir, he said, and it was a choir part. He said, oh man, what am I going to do? So he said, I'll see what I can do. Because you can't go there back in those days and not be ready.
Mm-hmm.
It puts a bad mark on your name and your reputation. So he kind of looked at the conductor in the booth and he said, oh, hey guys, the same opening you do, do the closing as well. And if you know that song, it opens with, if I had to choose just one day. And mm-hmm. So at the end, Nat finishes a phrase, that Sunday, and he has that long note at the end. And then the choir, there's nothing really on paper.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what he forgot. And so Nat is just basically hanging out there all by himself. And so he tells the choir, he said, when Nat does that, then at the ending go, if I had to choose just one day. Harmony. And they did it in one of the takes, the first and last take. And he looked at the producer in the booth, and the producer said, okay, that sounds great.
That's amazing. What a story.
One of his stories, yeah. One of the stories he told me is crazy funny.
Wow. Eddie, is there a particular song that when you sing it, you feel the strongest connection to Nat King Cole?
That's a very good question. I've never heard it quite put that way. Very, very well stated. I would probably say Stardust.
Huh.
Stardust is probably the one. Unforgettable is another for sure.
Okay.
You and I remember you, me, Ken, doing that on the promenade.
Yes.
And that was one of the songs in the song list. And that song really got one of the better responses. People, I think it's probably his most successful. And of course, Natalie, before she passed away, she did that with her father, using the vocals from the studio.
Mm-hmm.
David Foster and Phil Ramone, the producer. Yeah, it was quite a singular recording. That song is probably one of the most the most quintessential.
Okay, so back to Stardust, because that was the first song that you mentioned. So why does it resonate with you so deeply?
Well, because Stardust was, I think it was composed. It wasn't Johnny Mercer. And I don't think it was him. I think it was his country friend who wrote a few things like Stella by Starlight, Skylark. I think Skylark was the one he composed. And I forget that gentleman's name. Now it's escaping me. But I think Stardust is just a haunting, melodic composition. And I think that, it's difficult. If you don't have a degree or measure of intimacy with that song, you can easily get messed up.
Mm-hmm.
It's similar to Billy Strayhorn, Duke Ellington's song. It's just popular because maybe it resonates with people in that haunting way. Because the message, now the purple dusk of twilight time steals across the meadows of my heart. And you get images. It's very, very, very rich with imagery.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very poetic in that way. So I think maybe that's why. And of course, you think about any time you think about your life, and if you've lived any length of time at all, a few years, and you realize just how true that is, that sometimes you have love that's lost, and the breakup is not fun to go through. But when you have songs like that, it does the crying for you.
Yes, so true.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful, beautiful, Eddie. Well, and my last question to you. As a singer, how do you feel when you perform Nat King Cole's music in front of an audience? And what message or feeling do you hope to convey to your audience when you sing one of Cole's songs?
You know, the clip I sent you was of me and Tony Bennett. And Tony, I kind of see him, as many do, as the conserver of the American songbook. And his words, one day there'll come a time when because of Nat and others, and I would have to say Tony, now that he's gone, leaving, it's interesting, parenthetically, he's the oldest recipient of the Grammy Award, 96 years old, largely because of Lady Gaga working with him those years, close to the end of his career and his life. Documentary, we won't call it jazz, we will call it America's classical music. And that's what it is. I feel very much like him. I feel like the baton is passed to me and others from Tony, Johnny Mathis. We are the conservers of the American songbook. And when I sing that music, I feel that it's like an honor, and it's important for people to understand how that music should be experienced, very much like I experienced it as a kid. And hopefully there's an impact that's made where they understand it's important as well. I remember singing at a festival, and it was a grandfather there with his two grandchildren. And they could be no more than, I guess, 4 or 5 years old. And they sat there, they were like transfixed watching me sing.
Yeah.
Father came to me and he said, "You know what they said?" I said, "What did they say?" He said, "They told me that when I grow up, I want to sing like he does." so that's what it's all about. Now, this is America's music. This is our heritage. And I want to make sure it's protected and that it continues on to the next generation. And I love seeing young artists coming up and to tell them, hey, listen, if you really want a timelessness in the contemporary music you do, your original compositions, study the classics. Study America's classical music. And you will assure there's longevity to yours. I see that it's almost like, some people say Chinese food, you don't really get much nourishment and then you're hungry again. A lot of music has been devolved to that point where it doesn't have much endurance, longevity. So I think that the labels no longer control what you see. You can do that yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's the power of the music. You get a chance to make sure the next generation has it and enjoy the treasure trove of the benefits of that baptism and to take it to the next level.
Yes, yes, so true. Well, Eddie, thank you so much for this beautiful and very inspiring conversation. And thank you for preserving the musical heritage and being, as you said, the conserver of the American book song. And this is incredible that, you know, you continue giving life to music so that, you know, future generations can experience and feel it as well and take it to the next level. This is absolutely wonderful and inspiring, and very, very grateful to you for continuing to do this.
Yeah, I was saying thank you so much for having me, Masha. It was a pleasure to share with you.
Yes, thank you, Eddie. Thank you so much. Until next time.
All right.
Bye.
Next time. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you very much for tuning in to feel and experience the life of Nat King Cole in Los Angeles with my special guest, Eddie Wakes. If you enjoy my podcast, In the Mood for California, please sign up for future episodes at your preferred platform and please leave your feedback. I really appreciate your time and support. You can follow me on Instagram at In the Mood for California. And check out my website, www.inthemoodforcalifornia.com. I'm a realtor with Beverly and Company Luxury Properties, and my license number is 019-78714. Selling and buying homes with soul is not just my real estate strategy. It is an intuitive and holistic approach that embraces your values, aspirations, and conscious intentions. If you want to discover the power of mindfulness in your real estate journey with my compassionate guidance, I'm here for you. In the next episode, we'll journey to Simi Valley, where we'll get a chance to experience a unique harmony of this corner of Los Angeles. Cannot wait to see you there.
In the mood for California, feel the soul of old Hollywood.